about the future in store for the sons of Cain and their followers, the temple legend is also most eloquent. It states that from Cain descended Methuselah, who invented writing, Tubal-Cain, a cunning worker in metals, and Jubal, who originated music. In short, the sons of Cain are the originators of the arts and crafts. Therefore, when Jehovah chose Solomon, the scion of the race of Seth, to build a house for his name, the sublime spirituality of a long line of divinely guided ancestors flowered into the conception of the magnificent temple called Solomon's Temple. Though Solomon was only the instrument to carry out the divine plan revealed by Jehovah to David, but Solomon was unable to execute the divine design in concrete form. Therefore, it became necessary for him to apply to King Hiram of Tyre, the descendant of Cain, who selected Hiram Abiff, the son of a widow, as all Freemasons are called, because of the relation of their divine progenitor with Eve. Hiram Abiff then became Grand Master of the Army of Construction. In him, the arts and crafts of all the sons of Cain who had gone before had flowered. He was skilled beyond all others in the work of the world, without which the plan of Jehovah must have remained forever a divine dream, and could never have become a concrete reality. The worldly acumen of the sons of Cain was as necessary to the completion of this temple as the spiritual conception of the sons of Seth. And therefore, during the period of construction, the two classes joined forces, the underlying enmity being hidden under a superficial show of amity. It was indeed the first attempt to unite them. And had that been accomplished, the world history from then on would have been altered in a very material manner.
Man searching for beginning has always been more or less burdened with difficulty. It is very hard for the human mind to conceive the total absence of a created state. And so we are not surprised that some have taken the rather bold attitude that creation was the formation of something from nothing. This, however, was not a satisfactory interpretation. It did not meet the full need of the growing mind. It seemed wiser then, man speculating upon the mystery of life, to assume that prior to existence, as it was conceivable to him, there was something. And in the Greek, and in the Babylonian, and in the Egyptian philosophies, efforts to determine this pre-existing eternal condition, or something, took on relations to elements. Some held that fire was the eternal element and the root of all things, and that everything came from fire. Others, like Thales, held water to be the sovereignty, and that everything came originally from water. There were some who claimed air to be the parent of all elements, and still others earth. But in the course of time, the belief in the parenthood of fire and the parenthood of water took domination over the other two elements. And nearly all philosophical systems have been based upon the belief that either fire or water was the primordial substance of the world. Now, it's rather interesting that two extreme elements should be thus contrasted, and that in many instances the universal theory was based upon a compromise or a relationship of these two, as is the alchemistical problem of the production of the stone. or the wise man symbol, which was said by these alchemists to be the result of fire burning in water, and water feeding the flame of fire. Now, if by water we can conceive, as perhaps we should, the material generational concept of life, all life, all form, all worlds arising from a kind of amniotic fluid in space, we can have what might be termed man's generation concept, based upon things observed or noted in the physical world. Generation from fire, on the other hand, suggests a more attenuated and spiritous essence. Fire seems to imply the creation of things from an invisible sources rather than from visible ones. And through the study of these things, particularly in the light of more modern psychological thinking, fire seems to come to suggest the consideration of creation psychologically, or as emerging from the internal life consciousness of man himself. So a creation and vision for man's psychic life is likely to be a fire creation, one envisioned more primitively from his material life may be a water creation. And we have these, again, carrying on through religion, where we have fire cults and water cults powerfully represented. The fire on the altar, the water of purification, became in turn, in time, the symbol of spirit and body, or soul and form, or the internal and the external life of man. So man conceived of the spiritual world of which he was a part, originating in fire, and the material world or universe which he inhabited, originating in water. And from the union of these, the spiritual and the material, he recognized the rise of his own psychic life, or the emergence of all compound natures, bodies, processes which have become familiar to him.
The sons of Cain, descended from the fiery Lucifer spirits, were naturally proficient in the use of fire. By it, the metals hoarded by Solomon and his ancestors were melted into altars, lavers, and vessels of various kinds. Pillars were fashioned by workmen under the direction of Hiram Abiff, the arches to rest upon them. The great edifice was nearing completion when he made ready to cast the molten sea, which was to be the crowning effort, the merging of the molten metal of fire with the waters of faith. It was to be his masterpiece. It was in the construction of this great work that the treachery of the sons of Seth became manifest and frustrated the divine plan of reconciliation. They tried to quench the fire used by Hiram Abiff with their natural weapon water and almost succeeded. The incidents which led up to this catastrophe, their meaning, and the sequel will be revealed, ladies and gentlemen, on Monday night. Now again, I'm not making any judgments on this. I am just merely telling you it is what it is. Thus our opposition is not personal, but spiritual, and to be fought with the weapon of the Spirit, reason. We firmly believe it to be for the everlasting good of mankind that the Masons should win, and cannot therefore be sure to present the Catholic side in a perfectly unbiased manner.